picture for a moment a world frozen in time. A world where the latest innovation was the light bulb. No smartphones, no modern medicine, just a status quo unchanged for decades. It does sound unthinkable, right? Yet this is exactly where we might find ourselves if not for a crucial ingredient in our progress. Each of us here today holds a piece of the puzzle to face complex challenges of today. But the question is, how do we fit these pieces together? We're all here problem solvers. And I think we can all agree that the knowledge we have today is 100 miles off from the knowledge we have when the actual first light bulb was invented. But with all these knowledge that we have, come complex problems. And to solve these complex problems, we need new ideas that bring positive value and positive impact. What I'm discussing here is really innovation. And sometimes we innovate really well, but other times we are lacking. The World Health Organization, for example, has declared that we are lacking in innovation of antibiotics. And what that means is that bacteria are developing resistance faster than we are able to develop new antibiotics to fight them. So how do we really innovate better? Currently, we work in a very siloed manner, in a very specialized way. That's true that in school, we start off with a broad knowledge base, and then soon after that, we start delving deeper and deeper into one specific subject, and we carry that on throughout our higher education and also our careers. And then we work in specialized departments, and we really rarely talk to each other. I propose a different way, which is multidisciplinary learning and collaboration. In that way, people from different backgrounds come together in one specific team to solve one specific problem with one goal in mind. We've done this quite well in the past, and we've done this with things that we now take for granted. Let's say our phones. They're indispensable for us. We use them for communication, we use them for literally anything. But a lot of people from different backgrounds like mechatronics, product design, software engineering, mechanical engineering, and so on, had to come together in order to create this indispensable device that we now can't let go of. Another example is the Human Genome Project, where scientists from different backgrounds like biology, chemistry, data science, and others had to also come together and map out our DNA. And the last example would be automation. Really any automation, but specifically I'll talk about composite automation, which is currently on the rise. Composite automation, for it to be possible, a lot of fields have to come together again, like robotics, software engineering, process design, material science, just really various fields. They had to come together and make a process that is automatable and then actually automate it. But actually, sometimes we don't really do it that well. A study by the Harvard Review concluded that 75% of multidisciplinary or interdisciplinary teams are actually dysfunctional. And they attributed this to the fact that they don't really have clear goals and they don't have clear communication within the teams. So I guess the question is, how do we work effectively in a multidisciplinary environment? Well, in my PhD, I had to work in manufacturing, microbiology, precision engineering, among many different other fields, to solve my specific problem. And I think I gathered a pretty good idea of how to work in this kind of environment effectively. And I came up with 7 steps. The first step is to define the problem, and to define the problem really simply. Something that I really like to do is to think of my problem as if I want to explain it to school children. That's how well you need to define your problem. The second step would be to define the requirements that your solution has to have at a minimum for it to be viable. So the second step is to define solution requirements. Now that you have your problem defined really well and your solution's requirement defined also really well, you can start brainstorming backgrounds. What kind of people from what sorts of backgrounds would be really helpful for me in this problem, in solving this problem? And try to really think outside the box here. Don't go for the next logical thing. An engineering background, think of an artist, for example. How could they bring value to your project? So now that you have brainstormed backgrounds, you have a good idea of what types of fields of study could help you, you have to set a baseline to yourself with the people from this background. For example, you can start to learn the jargon of the specific field to make it easier for you to communicate with people from these backgrounds. Because sometimes they could use these really technical terms that you don't really understand, and it could really get hard to carry that conversation. So the next step is to identify these people. Do your research, start gathering names, find who could really be helpful to you in the field. And after that, you need to connect with them. So how do you connect? I think a really good way to connect is to show people that you appreciate their experience and knowledge in the field, and make them understand that this is exactly why you want them on your team. So try to connect personally and, yeah, ask them to share some advice with you or their experience. And now that you have a team, how do you really work efficiently with them? The key is to communicate. There's a term called collaboration chaos, in which chaos comes upon when people from different backgrounds collaborate and specifically come into a meeting. And they can keep talking in circles, maybe not understanding exactly what the problem is, how they can approach it. It will just be going in circles during the meeting, and you come out at the other end with no real actions. You're a bit more confused than when you came into the meeting. So I think what really helped me in my PhD was to use visual aids. And visual aids are really helpful, like figures, diagrams. They're really helpful to convey your ideas and what you're trying to say. And they're helpful for people to be able to give their opinions on what you're saying. I mean, reports are amazing. We all need reports at some point. But when you're collaborating in a multidisciplinary environment, usually their collaborators are quite busy, and they don't have time to go through a lengthy report. And it could get really difficult when they get to the part that is not really their expertise. So they might not be able to pinpoint any problems in your methodology or in the line of thought. And they might not be able to give you very detailed or relevant feedback. So use visual aids. The second tip I have for you about communication is to go into your meetings with a facilitator mindset. So when I was doing the first year of my PhD, I felt a lot of pressure to go into the meeting and try to update and show them what I've been working on. I've been doing all this work. But soon after that, I started to reflect, and I found that the meetings are not solely for that reason. They're there for you to be able to extract the knowledge from the people that you're presenting to or collaborating with. You need to try as much as you can to facilitate the talk and direct the questions to be able to come to a solution that is viable. And the last part of communication would be to ask questions. Keep asking why. There's a technique called the five whys, which you can use especially when you are presented with a solution to your problem. And in that technique, you keep asking why five times until you drill down to the essence of that solution to see if it's actually viable for your problem. So here, maybe you can go back to your requirements that you put earlier and check, oh, does that solution tick them all? And it's really important to appreciate the experience of others, but also make sure you understand what they're proposing, because you most likely are going to be the person at the intersection of all these fields, and you have the broader idea and the broader picture. So you might understand earlier if the solution is viable or not. So now that you have these seven steps, why don't you start small? If you're an engineer, talk to your microbiologist friend. If you're a microbiologist, talk to your colleague from human resources or even finance. And let's light the next light bulb together. I'm Sara Hawi, and thank you for listening to me.